you, Stephen. God is good. All the time. Folks, that's true. We don't think so. We don't feel like it. And the circumstances don't dictate it. God is still good all the time. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Folks, it is a joy and a privilege to be here today. I appreciate your Pastor Donnie and his incredibly talented family. That's amazing. I'm not one of those preachers that can sing. In fact, I've been asked not to sing. I'll certainly catch you. And that's true. But I'm impressed at how well they sing and how well they're talented. So I appreciate it. I do bring you greetings today from the Baptist State Convention and Milton Hollifield, our Executive Director and Treasurer. And I want to thank you all for your giving to the cooperative program. Folks, it's through the cooperative program that we're able to send missionaries literally all over the world, thousands of them. And we're able to plant churches in multiple languages all over North America. And it allows people like myself to be a state missionary. I have the privilege of traveling and speaking and teaching and training people all over the state. And it is a joy and a privilege to be able to do that and a great one to be here today. And so it's nice to be here. I was here a few years ago, I think, for association meeting. I preached on the power of the Holy Spirit in evangelism. This morning we'll be talking about lostness and why we should pray for and share with lost people. Earlier in the Sunday school hour, we talked about being an on-mission Christian, talking about lifestyle evangelism. This afternoon at 5, when we come back, we'll have some discussion time and have an opportunity to engage some of the ideas of how do we engage, invest, and invite people to be a part of God's kingdom. So we'll be looking at that in some very practical ways. So I'm honored to be here today, and if you'll bring up the PowerPoint there, Thomas, I appreciate that. Let me tell you a funny story in a minute. I want to introduce my family first. I've got 5 children. That one, Christian Prayer Life, I'll just tell you that. My oldest son is also in the Army. He and his wife, Logan. We are in Logan. They are stationed in Hawaii. That's a nice thing. If you're in the Army, you'll be stationed in Hawaii. So they got married in May and started his Army service in August. And then my 2 daughters on the far end, Courtney and Darcy, are both in East Carolina. They were in the Amazon this past summer on a medical mission trip. I'll tell you something that'll make your summer. I got a text one morning. We had 3 really great texts on that same morning, but Courtney texted us one morning and said, "Mom and Dad, you'd be glad to know that yesterday we saw an entire village on the Amazon pray to receive Christ." That'll make your summer. And then my youngest daughter, Harper, right there, she's 10, and she's staying with some friends. And my wife, Angela, and my 14-year-old son, Dawson, they are in Thailand right now, ministering to missionaries from IMB missionaries from Central Asia. And so pray for them. I haven't heard from them yet, so I'm hoping and trusting everything's okay. They got there last night. So anyway, that's my family, and it's been a blessing to have them. And I'll tell some more stories tonight. Let me tell you kind of a fun story that will jump us into this this time. There was this little girl, and she had gone to the pediatrician, and the doctor was talking to her, trying to connect with her, and he's talking to her about Barney and Sesame Street and Dora the Explorer. And so he puts the tongue compressor in her mouth and says, "I'm going to find the Cookie Monster in your mouth." And the little girl's a shy little girl, and she says, "No, sir." Looks at her ear and says, "I'm going to find Big Bird in your hair." And the little girl says, "No, sir." Then he puts the stethoscope on her heart. He says, "Am I going to find Dora the Explorer in your heart?" Now, this question, the little girl pops up. She said, "No, sir. Jesus is in my heart. Dora's in my underwear." This little girl had her priorities right, didn't she? Jesus was on her heart and Dora was somewhere else. Well, that's a fun little story. And this morning, let me ask us a serious question. If God Almighty, who is the great physician, if he were to put his stethoscope on your heart this morning, what's on your heart this morning? I hope Jesus is on your heart as well. But I hope also that you've got a lost person on your heart this morning. Somebody you're concerned about. Somebody, you're not being judgmental, somebody you care about. But you've got a friend or a family member or an associate or a relative, a neighbor, who you're concerned about where they're going to spend eternity. If you have somebody like that, just nod your head. If you've got somebody you're concerned about, just nod your head. As we move through this message this morning, I want you to think about that person, and I want you to be praying for them. And at our invitation time, I'm going to give you an opportunity to literally come to this altar and bow down and do business with God, as it were, on behalf of that person that God's put on your heart. So we're going to talk about that. My daughter, Courtney, she was the one on the far left, and all of my kids have blonde hair. She has the blondest hair. But she asked me a question when she was 6 years old that I'll never forget. We were in a restaurant. We got to know the waitress. We got to know her name and where she was going to school and all the things you need to connect. And she came and picked up our ticket, or picked up some of our plates and laid down our ticket. And she turned to walk away. And little Courtney looked up at me with her blue eyes and said, "Dad, aren't you going to tell her about Jesus?" And of course I did. But the question has never left me. Who's going to tell them about Jesus? How can I tell them about Jesus? Folks, I hope that question will be on your heart this morning. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. Father, you're the Almighty God. You're the God of creation. You're the God of redemption. Lord, you're the God of restoration. And Lord, you are the God of salvation. Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit would absolutely capture and captivate and take over this place and take over our hearts today. Father, I pray that you will be exalted and lifted up. I pray that your kingdom purpose will be accomplished in this church, in this church family, in each of our lives. Father, I pray that you will be glorified and Jesus will be exalted today. Father, I pray if there's somebody here today in the hearing of my voice who has never surrendered to Jesus as Lord and Savior, that today would be the day of surrender and salvation. And Father, I pray for all of us who know you that we would grow in your grace and knowledge and we have a greater burden for lost people. Father, change our hearts today. May our hearts be receptive. Open our eyes that we might see you and what you're trying to show us. Open our ears, Lord, that you might speak to us, that we might hear you and be obedient. Father, whatever attitudes that we have, help us to understand your attitude is that you love us, but you hate our sin because you're a holy God. Father, release us from all the distractions and all the sin that besets us. Father, transform our lives today that we would not be conformed to this world. We would not be conformed to churchianity. But Lord, we would be conformed to biblical Christianity in the image of your Son, Jesus. We pray in his powerful name. Amen. Amen. Well, this morning as we began to talk about why we should pray for and share with lost people, I shared an idea in the earlier time in the Sunday school hour about Jesus is the greatest, you fill in the blank. Jesus is the greatest, I talked about garbage man. He's the greatest doctor, plumber, electrician, teacher, coach. It doesn't matter what it is because Jesus is perfect, so he's going to be the greatest. So think of your own ideas. I was doing an exercise with a group of pastors one time on this same principle, and somebody in the back of the room said, "Hey, Marty, what about a phlebotomist?" I said, "A phlebotomist?" I said, "Isn't that somebody that studies blood?" They said, "Well, actually, it's somebody that draws blood." I said, "Well, that's easy. Jesus is the greatest phlebotomist of all time. He drew his blood for us on the cross." Amen. Amen. Well, I have a whole lot of kids, so I applied for a lot of life insurance, and the company sent this guy out to interview me and talk to me, and his name was Brian. And I said, "Brian," I said, "are you a phlebotomist?" And he said, "Well, yes, as a matter of fact, I am." He said, "I've been doing this for 11 years, but nobody ever asked me that." I said, "Well, Brian, do you know who the greatest phlebotomist of all time is?" He said, "I have to be real honest with you, sir. I've never thought about that." A lot of times people have never thought about how their job that Jesus would be the greatest to have. Well, long story short, I got to share the gospel with him and give him a Jesus video. Well, another opportunity, the Rex Bloodmobile came to the Baptist State Convention building, and we're right across the street from the mall. We're on the softer side of Sears, I like to say. And they had a bus, and they had five phlebotomists taking blood and five people giving blood, and it was my turn to get on the bus. So they sent me in the bus, and I was talking to this lady. I said, "How are you doing today?" She said, "Oh, I'm blessed." I said, "Well, me too. I'm too blessed to be depressed." And we're already having church. And I said, "Are you a phlebotomist?" She said, "Yes, I am. How'd you know that?" I said, "Well, let me ask you a question then." I said, "Do you know the greatest phlebotomist of all time?" She said, "Yes, I do. It's Jesus Christ." And she just went to preaching right then. And she said, "There's four ladies in my church that do what I do." And she said, "My preacher preached a sermon on Jesus is the greatest phlebotomist of all time." And man, she was preaching. Now, I was just going to sow a seed. You know, I talked about sowing and cultivating and harvesting. I was just going to sow a seed and have a one-on-one conversation with her. But what I did is I really struck a match. And folks, we just had church right there on the bus. I called it the Gospel Blood Bus. Amen? Folks, you have divine appointments with people who need to hear the gospel. But often you have divine intersections with people who are already Christians. And you just kind of have church right there. I've had it happen to me a number of times. Coming through the Atlanta airport, through security one time, a lady, I handed her a little Bible study track. I called them Bible studies. I said, "Maybe here's your little Bible study. When you get a chance, you take a look at it." And she said, "Do you love Jesus?" I said, "Well, yes, ma'am, I do. I love Jesus." And we just started talking. She was all excited. Now, she's more bold than me because the very next person in line, we're standing there talking, and all she's doing is checking our ID and making sure we've got a boarding pass. The very next lady in line, she looks at her and says, "Ma'am, do you love Jesus?" "We love Jesus. Do you love Jesus?" And the lady was very calm, and she said, "Well, yes, I do. I love Jesus." I said, "Ma'am, where are you from?" She said, "I'm a missionary with the North American Mission Board to Alaska. I was at the same conference you were at." So you never know what's going to happen when you're talking about Jesus. You find people want to listen and hear about it. All right, if you got your Bibles today, turn to 1 Timothy chapter 2. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 8. Christ are Paul's last letters. Paul knows that his life is about to come to an end. Folks, if you know that your life is about to come to an end, what you say and what you do and what you write about is going to be very important. You're probably going to be pretty passionate about it as well. And in this passage is no different, because as Paul is trying to encourage young Timothy in the faith, he's talking to him about prayer, and he's talking to him about worship, and he's specifically talking to him about prayer in the church. And just as the beloved men sang today about we believe, folks, we believe these things, but we need to be passionate about sharing. We need to be passionate because Jesus is coming back, and it is very possible that it could be in our lifetime. We don't know exactly when, we don't know the day or the hour, but we know that it is possible. We know that many things have already been fulfilled, and we need to be on a mission every day, amen? Amen. So as we look at this passage of Scripture, this is an awesome passage of Scripture from Paul to Timothy. He's talking about prayer in the church, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. Hear God's word. He says, first of all, or foremostly then, I urge that entreaties and prayers and petitions and thanksgivings be made on behalf of all men, for kings and all who are in authority, in order that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. Verse 3, this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved. You can say all people to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator also between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony born at the proper time. Paul says in verse 7, it was for this I was appointed a preacher, an apostle. I'm telling the truth, I'm not lying. As a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth, verse 8, therefore I want the men in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and without dissension. May God add his blessing in our understanding and in our obedience to his word. Now folks, this is written in very male language, but in verse 8, he really is talking about men being spiritual leaders. But when you go back to verse 1, he says, first of all, or for most of them, he said, make it a priority. And then he says, I urge you to make entreaties, prayers, petitions, and thanksgivings. He's basically saying every kind of prayer. But he uses the word urge, I urge you. That word urge is parakaleo. Para means to come alongside, and kaleo means to call out to somebody. Folks, this is a strong, passionate word. It's a little bit stronger than just encouraging somebody. It's exhortation. It's kind of like a coach when his runner is in the last lap of the race and he's getting tired, and the coach is saying, I know you can make it. I know you can do it. It's passionate encouragement. And that's what Paul's saying. Now, put this in the vernacular. What Paul is saying is, folks, I want you to pray hard. I want you to pray in every way, and I want you to make it a priority. That's what he's really saying. And he goes on in this passage. He is passionate. He's talking to Timothy, and he tells him in verse 3, he says, this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Well, folks, let's talk about that for a minute. God desires people to be saved. Well, Almighty God is sovereign, but he does not decree that everybody's going to be saved. He can decree it. He can say everybody's going to be saved, and everybody be saved. But God doesn't decree that, but it is his heart's desire, amen? So, folks, if it's God's desire for people's salvation, should that not also be our desire as well? Yes, it sure should be. That's the first big reason why we should be praying for and sharing with lost people, people who are lost without Christ. Now, when we use the term lost, a lot of times we say that person's lost. Well, that has a pejorative or a negative sound, but I want you to know something. Lost people have value to Jesus, amen? Because Jesus said he came to seek and to save that which is lost. Let's say you lose a pen or something. You may spend a few minutes looking for that pen, but then you just go get another one because it doesn't have that much value. But I'm going to tell you something. If you lose your car keys or you lose your cell phone, you're going to spend some time looking for those jokers, amen? Because they have value to you. See, lost people have value to Jesus. He came to seek and to save that which is lost. So that's our first big reason. Then he goes on in verse 5. He says, there is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Folks, what is a mediator? Well, a mediator is like a lawyer. It's like an advocate, somebody that speaks on your behalf, somebody that does something on your behalf, intervenes for you. You see, folks, Jesus is our mediator. Jesus is our lawyer. Look at this illustration. Let's say it's judgment time, and people are coming before Jesus in judgment. He goes, hey, this was mine. I died for him. Come on in your inheritance. We celebrate. This was mine. I died for him. We celebrate. But what happens when somebody comes before Jesus and he says, whoa, depart from me. I never knew you. We don't want that to be said to anyone. But folks, for those who are without Christ, who do not have him as their mediator, he's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. See, Jesus is our lawyer. Jesus is the one that stands before the Father on our behalf to say whether or not we get in. And we don't want anyone to be told, depart from me, I never knew you. So we need to know that Jesus is our mediator. He's our lawyer. He's our advocate with the Father. Because he goes on in verse 6 and says, he gave himself as a ransom for all, a testimony born at the proper time. Folks, what is a ransom? Most of the time when we think about a ransom, we think somebody has been kidnapped and they have to pay money to buy them back. Folks, that's what Jesus has done for us. The Bible says he has purchased us with his own blood. He has ransomed us. Jesus has purchased us. He has paid for something that you and I didn't deserve, didn't earn, and could not pay for ourselves. He has purchased us. He has ransomed us with his own blood. Amen? There's a lot of great things in this passage. It is just a rich passage of Scripture. But we need to move on. But that's our first big reason why we should pray for and share with lost people, because God's Word urges us to do so. Now, Jesus also taught us in what we call the Lord's Prayer to pray for his kingdom to come. You can probably see that. Matthew 16 is up in the right corner. In Matthew chapter 6, we call that the Lord's Prayer. But it's really the disciples' prayer, and it's really a model prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed, holy be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And it goes on from there. But Jesus is teaching us in that several different principles of prayer. And one of them is to pray for his kingdom to come and his will to be done. Now think about this. How many times do you sit down and go to pray for somebody and you don't really know exactly what to pray for? And we pray things like, Lord, please help them, Lord, bless them, Lord, protect them. And you know what? But a lot of times we don't go beyond that because we're really not sure what to pray. But Jesus said, pray that his kingdom would come and his will would be done. So folks, when we pray God's word, for his kingdom to come and his will to be done in someone's life, not only are we praying what he wants us to pray, we're praying his word. And when we pray his word, we're praying his heart. And we want to pray the heart of God, amen? As you know, I have 5 children, and by the grace of God, all of them have come to know Christ. All of them have been baptized. They've been serving in different ways. But you know what? My wife and I pray all the time that God would capture their hearts, that God will capture their hearts. Because you know what, folks? We can pass on our values and we can pass on our stuff to another person. But you cannot pass on your salvation, and you cannot pass on God's calling on your life. Because God saves people individually, and God calls people individually to different things. So one of the things that we passionately pray for our children is that God would capture their hearts. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in their life. Because really, isn't that what you want for your children, for your grandchildren, for those that you're praying for? Don't you want God's kingdom to come and his will to be done? That's what we really want to. So folks, we ought to passionately pray, Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done in the lives of our friends, in our relatives, our associates, our neighbors, our children. Now, look at this statement by evangelist Sammy Tippett. He said, when one prays for the will of God and the kingdom of God, he's in essence praying for the same thing. He's praying for Jesus to rule and reign in the hearts of men and women, boys and girls. And folks, that's what we want, for his kingdom to come, his will to be done. Amen? Amen. So that's our second thing. Pray God's word and pray for people for his kingdom to invade people's hearts and lives. So, God's word urges us. Jesus taught us. Then Paul modeled prayer for lost people. In Romans 10:1, he said, brethren, my heart's desire, my prayer to God is for their salvation. Well, who is Paul talking about? Well, he's talking about his own people. Now think about this. When you're most passionate about things, we care about other people, but we're most passionate about our immediate family. You know, blood's thicker than water. We care the most about our children and our grandchildren and those immediately around us. And we'll stop everything if something comes up, an emergency, to go deal with that. But if you want to see how passionate Paul really is for his own people in Romans 10, you've got to back up and see what he said in Romans chapter 9. Because in Romans chapter 9, verse 1, he says, I'm telling the truth in Christ. I am not lying. The Holy Spirit bear witness. And he says in Romans 9:2, he says, I have great sorrow and unceasing grief in my heart for the sake of my kingdom. What he's saying there, folks, is his heart is literally broken over his own people. His heart is broken. When is the last time that God broke your heart or my heart over someone's soul? When's the last time that we shed a tear over someone's soul? We've got to ask God to break our hearts, to make us sensitive to the spiritual destinies of other people. Because Paul's heart's broken over his own people. And he goes a step further in verse 3, and he says this in Romans 9:3. He says, I wish that I myself were accursed and separated from Christ for the sake of my kinsmen. Pastor Donnie, the first time I read that, I thought when Paul said accursed and separated, I thought, is Paul saying what I think he's saying? Paul's saying that he would be willing to be separated eternally in a place that the Bible calls hell if everybody could be saved. And I thought, whoa, that's heavy. And I began to think about that. I began to apply that to myself, and I thought, would I be willing to do that if everybody could be saved? And I thought for a moment, I said, I don't ever want to be separated from Christ. Do you want to be separated from Christ? No. Do you want your friends or family or loved ones to be separated from Christ? No. And as I began to ponder that, all of a sudden, glory, hallelujah, some good news came to mind. We don't have to. Jesus has already done it for us on the cross, amen? Jesus did it for us on the cross when he cried out, Lord, Lord, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? Folks, for a split time in all of eternity and all of history, God Almighty turned his back on Jesus, and Jesus took on your sins and my sins and the sins of the whole world onto himself, such that his heart literally burst within him. In that moment, Jesus experienced hell for us so we would not have to if we accept what he has done for us. Amen? Amen. See, that's some good news in the middle of some bad news. So when Paul says he had unceasing grief and he would be willing to be accursed and separated, that's a powerful thing, and that's the passion that God wants us to have. But the good news is, Jesus has already done it for us. Amen? And so we don't have to. Now, along these same lines, I'm going to tell you a couple of stories, illustrations. I was jogging in my neighborhood one Saturday morning, about 9:30 in the morning. Got down to the one end of the neighborhood that has a cul-de-sac, and my retired Army neighbor that I had the privilege of baptizing, and next door to him is a retired Air Force guy named Mike. And I hadn't seen Mike in a while, but he was working in his yard. He's a quiet guy, has a Catholic background. And so I made my second circle around and kind of went up to him. And he kind of came up to the edge of the yard. And you could kind of tell when somebody wants to talk. They kind of have something on their heart. And Mike's not real talkative, so I wasn't really sure, but I could tell. And so I began to talk to him, and we chit-chatted about work and military and different things. And so then I began to make that spiritual transition. And I said, Mike, have you been to St. Mary's Church? Been to St. Mary's Church lately? That's the Catholic church in Garden. And he said, well, Marty, I haven't been to church as much as I should, but I've been reading the Bible. I said, you have? I said, well, that's interesting. Tell me about it. He said, well, one of the things I discovered is Jesus' suffering didn't begin with the beating and the crucifixion. It began in the garden. I said, now, Mike, are you talking about the Garden of Gethsemane? Or are you talking about all the way back to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden? He said, no, all the way back to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. When Adam and Eve sinned and were kicked out of the garden, he said, that's when I believe the suffering began. I said, man, that's incredible insight. I agree with you. He said, that's not all. He said his greatest suffering wasn't even the beating or the crucifixion. His greatest suffering was the separation from the Father on the cross. I said, oh, Mike, I said, I absolutely agree with you. That's incredible insight. I said, there are seminary professors who don't have that kind of insight. You know what I mean? I said, well, tell me something. How did you come to that understanding? Folks, this is what he told me. He said, Lord, I've not explained it to you, but for about a year now, I've been reading the Bible. I've been reading God's Word, and the Holy Spirit has been teaching me God's Word, and the Holy Spirit has been showing me God's Word. Amen. Amen. Folks, that's why we pray. That's why we pray. You and I may not have an effect on some water. We may not see the effect we have, but the Spirit of God, when He begins to move on people's lives and call them and draw them to Himself, it's the work of the Holy Spirit. And folks, I was so excited that as Mike was telling me this, as I ran back up the hill that day, it was like I floated back up the hill. And I've been praying and asking God questions, and it was kind of like God said, Marty, I heard your prayers. I've heard your prayers, and I am at work, and I just wanted to show you today just this little bit of how I'm at work. Folks, that's why we got to pray, that God would call and draw people to himself. And sometimes we don't see what's happening. See, Paul was passionate about his own people. My grandmother, Ruth, had the greatest influence of any family member on my life. She died in February of 1999, which was about 16 years ago. It was right after I came to the convention. I was so excited I was going to be close to my grandmother. She lived on a farm in Four Oaks, North Carolina, in Johnson County. She grew up in Benson, and she lived to be 93 years old. And at her funeral, about 250-some people came to her funeral. And that's a lot of people for somebody that lives on a rural farm in Johnson County. They're 93 years old. That's a lot of people who come to your funeral. One person after another said to me, Miss Ruth did this for me. Miss Ruth prayed this for me. And my grandmother was a quiet lady. She never spoke out loud in church. She never held an office. But she knew how to get in touch with God. My grandmother taught me to pray for lost people. I was never with my grandmother when she didn't end our conversation by saying, "Let's pray." And she prayed for the normal things you pray for, but she always prayed for souls. And when she was 86 years old, she gave me two cards and a stack of poems. And she said, "Marty, I want you to share this at my funeral." I said, "Well, grandmother, you're in good health. You're still driving." She said, "Oh, yes, but don't ever pray for me to stay. Because when that time comes, I'm ready to go." Are you ready to go? Whether you're 8 years old or 18 years old or 48 or 78 or 98, we need to be ready to go when that time comes. Amen? Well, the poems are about the cross and the crown. But the card, there was two cards. One of them had our mission statement in life. And it says, "May I have lived a life that will light someone's pathway and they'll see Christ in my life." Well, she lived out a mission statement. Do you have a mission statement for your life? But the other card is the one that really grabbed my attention. And it reminded me of what Paul said in Romans 10. He said, "Brethren, my heart's desire, my prayer to God is for thy salvation." In my grandmother's card, this is what it said. It said, "My greatest desire in life is to know that all of my family is saved and living in the ark of safety, knowing Jesus as their Savior and ready to meet Him when that day comes." Isn't that what you want? Isn't that precious? That's what you and I want for our friends and our family, to be living in the ark of safety, knowing Jesus as their Savior and ready to meet Him when that day comes. That's exactly what Paul was saying. His heart's desire, brother, my heart's desire, my prayer to God is for their salvation. Folks, we've got to have that heart. We've got to ask God to give us that heart if we don't have it. So God's Word urges us. Jesus taught us to pray. Paul wanted to pray for lost people. And now we're going to look at the conditions of losses. Now, before I even jump into this, I want to say this to you. I want you to think about this. Do not let this be sterile information. I know you can be sitting there today and you can be saying, "Yeah, I know the Bible says that. I know the Bible says that." I want you to personalize this. Because you're here today and you're in one of two conditions. Either you're here today and you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you have absolutely no doubt about that. If you die right this second, you know that you're going to heaven and you have no doubt about that. But perhaps you're here today and you're not 100% sure about where you're going to go. Or maybe you've never really surrendered to Jesus. This is what the Bible says is about our conditions without Christ. This is who we are without Christ. Now, that person you're praying for today who is without Christ, this is what the Bible says about their conditions. Let's look at it. First of all, it says we're blind. The Bible says in Corinthians, it says the gospel is veiled to those who are perishing. That the gods of this age, the little gods of this age, the god of this age, the evil one, has blinded the eyes of the unbelieving that they may not see the glory of the gospel of Christ, which is the image of God. Think about that. Spiritual blindness. Have you ever had a conversation with somebody and you were trying to get them to see things your way and they just couldn't see things your way? If you're a parent, you've had a teenager, you've had that conversation. If you're a teenager and you've tried to talk to your parents, you've had that conversation. We can't get on the same page sometimes with people because they don't see it the way we do. Well, if you are a Christian and you're talking to somebody else who is not a Christian, they are spiritually blind. You perhaps have a Christian worldview and they don't. It's very hard to get on the same page with them. I have a neighbor. His nickname is Sarge, and he's never been in the military, so he's a tough guy. In fact, he likes to brag that I'm his toughest challenge. Now, he and I agree about a lot of stuff, politics, a lot of other things. He's a good neighbor. We get along really well. But he doesn't see things like I do. And I even said to him one day, I said, "Greg, you and I agree about a lot of things, but we don't see things spiritually the same." He said, "Yeah, you got that about right." And the difference is, God has not opened his eyes spiritually. He is spiritually blind. And so that can be a challenge. But folks, we've got to pray that God would open their eyes. Amen? Because you and I may not be able to get those eyes right open, but God can open their eyes. And we pray that. Now, the second thing is, we are bound. If you still got your Bibles open to Timothy, flip over real quickly to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 25 and 26. I'm going to read something to you there. 2 Timothy 2, 25 and 26. Talking about being bound. This passage uses good hunting fishing language. Paul now is talking to Timothy about being a soldier of Jesus Christ. And in this passage, he's talking about being a servant soldier. And he says to him in verse 25, "With gentleness or meekness, correcting those who are in opposition, if perhaps God may grant them repentance, leading to the knowledge of the truth, that they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will." Wow, this is loaded. Notice the attitude that it says, with gentleness or meekness, correcting or confronting those in opposition. Folks, this passage of Scripture makes the assumption that you and I are going to engage people. We're going to invite them. We're going to engage them in conversation. We're going to talk about spiritual things. But notice it says, with gentleness or meekness, which is strength under control. Then it says, confronting or talking about, you know, those who are in opposition. Then it says, if perhaps God may grant them repentance. See, it's up to us to talk to them, but then it's on God to save them. You and I don't save anybody. God does the saving, but He uses you and I to engage Him. So we're confronting in gentleness and meekness, and it says, if perhaps God may grant them repentance. And then it says, leading to the knowledge of truth, that they may come to their senses. All right, that idea of coming to your senses is coming to a right way of thinking. It's where we get the word metanoia. It's where we get the word repentance. Now, let's say this is God here at the pulpit, and we're going away from God. A lot of times we talk about repentance is making a U-turn and coming back to God in a physical way. But what this passage is really talking about is that we've gone away from God in our thinking. We've got some stinking thinking, and our thinking isn't right. All of a sudden, we come to our right mind and think, my thinking's not right. I need to think like God wants me to think. And it's a change of mind to be like and think like God wants us to think. Now, it says that they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil. That snare is like a bear trap. It says if somebody stepped into that trap, and that trap's got you. You can't get out of that trap. Somebody else has to come and push that lever and open that trap to allow you to escape. That's the picture that's in this language. It's ensnarement, entrapment. And folks, that's what the evil one does to us until we're set free. Folks, when we're praying for somebody who's without Christ, we're engaged in a spiritual battle because that person is held captive. The Bible says that someday the Messiah will come to set the captives free. Folks, we know that Jesus is that Messiah that has come to set the captives free. Amen? So when you're praying for somebody who's held by the grip of the evil one, we're engaged in a spiritual battle, in a total war for their soul. And we're praying for them to be set free from that grip on their life. Folks, we fight the wrong battles in churches all the time. If we're arguing over colors and cushions and carpets and curtains and all that stuff, that's personal preference, and that's the wrong battle. But folks, if you start praying for lost people and you start sharing your faith, you've now stepped onto the battlefield, but it's the right battle because it's an eternally significant battle. Amen? Amen. So let's make sure that we're always engaged in the right battle. So as we pray, we'll pray for God to open their eyes. We'll pray for God to set them free. And then the third thing is, the Bible says that we are condemned by our own sin. In John 3:18, I trust that you know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. When you get to verse 17, it says God didn't send His Son into the world to judge the world or condemn the world, but the world might be saved through Him. Amen? That's what He's called us to. But verse 18 says, he who believes is not condemned or is not judged, but he who does not believe is condemned already because of his unbelief. So folks, God doesn't have to condemn us. We don't have to condemn one another. We're already condemned. We're condemned by our own lack of belief and by our own lostness. And folks, we need to pray for people to understand that God loves them, but he hates their sin. So without Christ, we're blind, we're bound, we're condemned. Now look at this next one. This next one is a heavy one. And it's one that we don't particularly like. We are under God's wrath, and we are destined for hell without Christ. Now, folks, if you and I were writing the Bible, we wouldn't put that in there because we don't like this idea. But you know what? Jesus talked about hell more than anybody. But the good news is we already know He came to do something about it. Amen? Now, it says in John 3:36, it says, he who believes in the only begotten Son of God has eternal life. But he who does not believe the wrath of God abides on him. Folks, what is the wrath of God? The wrath of God is a perfect, holy God's hatred towards sin or anything that goes against Him. Anything that's unholy, anything that's unrighteous, anything that's sinful. Folks, we can never even get close to the holiness of God because He is so perfect and so incredible. Moses said, Lord, can I see your face? And he basically told Moses, you can't see me and live, but you can hide in the cleft of the rock and I'll pass by and you can be sunburned by my afterglory. And that's not exactly what it says, but that's exactly what it means. Because Moses was burned by the backside of the glory of God. Folks, see, we've gotten away from this in our culture. We've gotten away from this in our church culture about the perfection and the holiness of God. We've got this idea that God's our buddy and we give a million years on him. Don't get me wrong. He is Abba Father. We can sit in His lap and talk to Him as a loving father, loving grandfather. He loves us. But he is not our buddy. God is other than us. God is creator, and we're his creation. He did not create us for us. He created us for his purpose and his glory and his kingdom. Just like a soldier or a marine in a military operation, when they go out on a mission, it's all about the mission. It's not about the individual soldier or marine. It's all about the mission. And each one of them are expendable for the sake of the mission. Folks, in God's economy, you and I as Christians are expendable for the sake of his mission. We forget that sometimes because we've made life and church and our spirituality about us and not necessarily about God. God is a holy God, and he has a plan, and he wants to use us. He is not finished with us. He's not finished with you until he takes you home. Whether you're 8 years old or 88 years old, until God calls you home, he still has your own mission here and his purpose and a plan. Amen? He's not finished with us. Now, how many of y'all saw Chronicles of Narnia? Or you've read the book, Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe? Good number of you have. There's a beautiful illustration of there. Aslan is the lion. Aslan is the God figure. He's the Christ figure. And I think it was Edward and Peter, or Peter and James, I can't remember. They're having a conversation about Aslan, who is the lion. He's the God figure. And one of the little boys says to the other boy, "Is he safe? Is he safe?" And I love the answer. "Oh no, he's not safe, but he's good." And folks, that's how our God is. He's not a safe God, but he's a good God. Amen? Because when God calls you, you may not necessarily be in a safe area. My wife and son and the team from our church are ministering to people who are in a non-safe area in Central Asia. That's where they are today. To give them a break and allow them some refreshment from being in a really difficult Muslim country. So that's an amazing thing. It's not necessarily safe, but he's holy and he's good and he's perfect. Now, let me raise a question and try to answer. If God is a good God and he loves everyone, why does there have to be a hell? Why does there even have to be a hell? What we're talking about is because the holiness of God. God is holy, holy, holy. The angels, in a typical response, chant back and forth in the heavens, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who is and was and is to come." In the holiness of God, there's two aspects of his holiness. One, he's a just God. And because he's a just God, he can't allow anything unholy or unrighteous or sinful to come into his presence and even exist. That's one aspect of it. The other aspect of a holy God is that he is a loving God. He loves people unconditionally. He loves people right here in New Hanover County that will die today or die tomorrow or next week and never know about the love of Jesus. Folks, that's our mission, is to tell them about his love. Amen? Because watch what God did. Because he loves unconditionally, he sent Jesus to cover our injustice, to cover our unrighteousness, to cover our unholiness. So when you go back to my illustration earlier, and people are coming before him in judgment, and he said, "Hey, this was mine, I died for him, come on in your inheritance," we celebrate. "This was mine, I died for her," we celebrate. But what happens when that one comes before me? He says, "Lord, depart from me, I never knew you." Matthew 7:21 and following. Folks, that is a tragic reality of eternity without Jesus Christ. It's not a Halloween joke, it's not a joke at all. It's a serious condemnation on a lost person without Christ. But here's what's so disturbing about Matthew 7. That person turns around and saying to him, "But Lord, Lord, didn't we do miracles and cast out demons and do all of that in your name?" He said, "Depart from me, I never knew you." Here's the tragedy. That's a religious person that he's talking to. And he's sending them away because they didn't know him. When Jesus comes for you and I, he's not looking for our list of what we did or our church attendance. He's looking for his son in us. That's all he's looking for. And if he does not see his son in us, he has to say, "Depart from me, I didn't know you." So the real question is, do you really know Jesus? Have you really surrendered your life to him and given to him? That's what he really wants to know. I know this is a heavy topic, but I want to tell you a funny story. And I want to give you permission to laugh because this is really funny. My wife, on her 40th birthday, decided she wants to go snow skiing. I said, "Snow skiing, are you serious?" She said, "Yeah, we can go up to Banner Elk to Beach Mountain on Wednesdays." It's called Retro Wednesdays. It's 1970s prices. It's only $25 for a lift ticket and skis. I said, "$25 for a lift ticket and skis? Honey, that sounds like our copay on our insurance. We're going to get hurt." She said, "No, we'll be fine. We'll get somebody to keep the drive, and we'll go up." And we went up on a Tuesday night. It snowed beautifully. The next morning, 27 degrees. Wasn't a cloud in the sky. Wasn't windy. It was just a perfect day. Nice snow. I get on the shuttle and go up to the ski lodge, and I slip and fall laying flat on my back. This guy from New Jersey looks down at me and says, "Hey, buddy, I hope that's not an indication of your day." I was thinking the exact same thing. Good news is I skied all day and didn't get hurt. I fell down one more time. But I have lots of opportunities to witness to people. But we had one opportunity at the end of the afternoon. My wife said, I'm not going to ski the long trail again. I'm just going to ski the green slope. I'll meet you back in Hawaii. I said, well, I'm going to ski from the top of the long trail one more time. So I get on this quad lift with these three dudes. Now, they called me dude. They called each other dude. They said dude every third word. They could have started that movie, Dude, Where's My Car? I mean, you got a picture of this. These guys had long toboggans all the way down the ground, big old floppy t-shirts. They're all little trick skis. And here I'm with a 40-something-year-old guy. I got these big old skis, big old ski poles. And they're laughing their heads off. And I'm thinking to myself, I know I'm goofy, but I can't be that funny. But you got a picture of this. I'm dude number one, dude number two, dude number three, and dude number four. I mean, we're all in this little quad lift. And why does this lift move forward? These guys are all squatting down, and they got their arms piling up snow. Folks, this is a boys only be boys at its finest. They've been doing it all day long. That's why they're laughing so they can't talk. And all three of them are sitting there with a cannonball-sized snow in their lap. And they've been dropping their ordinances on people as they go up the lift. So I start laughing now because I know what's going on. I say, hey, guys, my wife has curly blonde hair. You can't miss her. She's going to be coming out from behind those trees in just a minute. They were ready to drop on her. But she cuts and goes a different direction. So now they start hollering, woo, go, girl. My wife told me, like, hold on, attention. She looks up and sees me kind of waste. What is going on? And just like that. A bunch of college guys. They were skipping school from Appalachia, 19, 20 years old. They're all from the Atlanta area. These three dudes. Well, after they dropped all their ordinances, and it was all fun watching them drive. I had some little cars that have Michelangelo artwork on one side, and the cross is a bridge on the other. Maybe you can't see it. It's a little bookmark. It's kind of hard to handle a gospel tract, which I call a Bible study with ski gloves on. But I can open my little ski bib, and I can pass out these little cars. And I said, hey, guys, let me test your art history. And Pastor Bailey looked at me. Oh, yeah, some dude painted that some church in Italy, right? I said, do you remember his name? He goes, the Leonardo da Vinci dude. I said, well, actually, it was the Michelangelo dude. That church you're talking about is called the Sistine Chapel. It's in the Vatican in Rome. Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. I said, well, if you remember, Michelangelo, the ceiling in the Vatican, painted a picture of God in the clouds, in the heavens, reaching down to Adam in the garden. It's the hand of God, the hand of man. It's called the creation man. I said, but if you remember the story about Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, they messed up, and they got kicked out of the garden. That's the disconnect with God. I said, but if you flip the card over, it's got the cross, and the cross is a bridge back to God. It's the way that God reached down to us to draw us back. It's through the cross. You got to remember, I'm dude number one. By this time, dude number four leans out and says, hey, dude, by the way, I'm a Christian. But these dudes, they're going straight to hell. I mean, straight to hell. He just busted out. I mean, it was out of nowhere. So I thought, I wasn't even sure he was serious. I thought he was just shaking my chain and being sarcastic. And so we all laughed. And then a few minutes later, he said, man, it's 27 degrees, and they're just cooling off before they go straight to hell. And he lit back into them again. We laughed again because it was kind of abrupt. But then after they calmed down a minute, I said, guys, I said, I know we're laughing at what he said. I said, but it's really not funny. I said, because that's what the Bible really says about a person without Jesus Christ. And that's when he leans in again. He says, I know, man, I know. That's what I've been trying to tell him. That's what I've been trying to tell him. When we got off at the top of the mountain, they're getting ready to go down the Black Diamond. I would never do that. But he says to me, thank you for preaching to my buds. I've been preaching to them too. I said, oh, I can tell you're preaching to them. Folks, he was being sarcastic, but he was telling the truth and trying to be funny about it. But the reality is he was telling them the truth. And you and I, with tears in our eyes and love in our heart, we got to tell people that we're going to be separated eternally from God if we don't have Jesus in our life. And we didn't make up those rules. That's God's plan. But he has a plan to redeem us. And the good news is we can accept Jesus and change all that. Amen? And that's what we need to do. Real quickly, a couple more things here. Without Christ, we're blind, we're bound, we're condemned, we're under God's wrath, we're destined for hell. We're also helpless. In John 6:44, Jesus is speaking. He said, no one comes to the Father, or no one comes to me unless the Father draws them to me. Folks, that's why we got to pray. The Spirit of God has to call and draw people to himself. We're helpless with that. And then the last thing, if you still got your Bibles open, look at Ephesians chapter 2. We're going to hit this real quick. Ephesians chapter 2. I call this the Clint Eastwood passage of Scripture, because this has got the good, the bad, the ugly all in one passage of Scripture. It starts off with some really bad news, but it ends with some really good news. Ephesians chapter 2, beginning with verse 1, it says, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins. That means spiritually dead. In verse 2, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them, we too all formerly lived in the lust of our flesh, indulging the desires of our flesh and of our mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. And folks, there's some hip-hop group or something called Naughty by Nature. I don't know if they got it from the Bible, but they got it right. We are naughty by nature. You don't have to teach people how to sin, amen? We have to teach people how not to sin. That's all the bad news. That's how bad we're. But the good news starts in verse 4 when it says, but God. Folks, anytime you're reading along in the Bible, you're studying something, and everything's terrible, all of a sudden when God shows up, God is the game changer. And in this one it says, but God, being rich in mercy because of his great love, for which he has loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, he has made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you have been saved, and you've been raised up with him, and seated with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Folks, that's some really good news, and it's all for a reason. Verse 7 says, in order that in the ages to come that he might show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Then verses 8, 9, and 10 you're probably very familiar with. It says, for by grace you've been saved through faith. It's a gift of God. It's not a result of works, lest anyone should boast. And then verse 10. I love verse 10. One of my favorite verses. It says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works that God has prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. That word workmanship is the word poema. It's the word poem with an A on the end of it. What does that mean? Folks, that means we're God's crafted work of art. We're not an afterthought or a second thought. We're God's crafted work of art. He created us with a purpose and a mission. And whatever it is you love to do, you can do it for Jesus. Amen? If you're into gardening, or you're into golf, or you're into crochet, or you're into computers, or carpentry, or whatever it is you love to do, you can do it for Jesus. I love sports. I played 3 sports in high school. I've been coaching sports for the last 17 consistent years anyway. This is my 17th spring of baseball. And I go on a mission trip somewhere every year and use sports as a way to share the gospel. I'll be down at Deep Impact at Oak Island. And we've done it in inner city here in Wilmington. And I've been all over Brunswick County. I probably was in Shalot. I'll be in Shalot again. And then I've been all over the world. The Philippines, Honduras, St. Lucia. Yes, I fought for Jesus in the Caribbean. I've seen more people come to Christ through basketball camps than anything I've done. So whatever it is you love to do, do it for Jesus. Amen. Now, a lot of times we're like Moses. God calls us to do something, and we start finding all the reasons not to do it, mostly focused on ourselves, not on God. But Moses was out in the desert. Here's a summary of Moses' life. Moses spent 40 years learning to be a somebody in the court of Egypt. Then Moses spent 40 years in the desert learning to be a nobody. Then he spent the last 40 years trying to teach nobodies how to be somebodies. Amen? That's kind of a summary of Moses' life. Well, while Moses was in the desert, God appeared to Moses in the burning bush and says, Moses, I am that I am. I'm God. I am Yahweh. I am the true God. And Moses, this is what I want you to do. He said, I want you to go and deliver the Israelites from the Egyptians. And Moses started in like you and I with his excuses. Oh, I'm not your man. I don't have to do that. I'm not a good talker. Theologically speaking, basically God said, Moses, shut up. I already know all that. Moses, what is that in your hand? And it was a shepherd's crook. He said, Moses, throw it down. He throws it down. Whoop, it turns into a snake. And that would take a lot more faith for me. But anyway, he says, now pick it back up. He picks it back up. It turns back into a shepherd's staff. And you know what he says? He said, Moses, I'm going to use what you already have in your hand to accomplish my mission. And Moses used that staff, that rod, to do all those miracles. And you know what? That's the message to you and I. God didn't call you to be Donnie Lovett or Marty Dupree or Billy Graham or somebody else. He called you to be who you are with your name and with your passion and with your skills and with your interest and your personality. And he wants to use you as you are. And to use the things you love to do, the things he's given you a talent or ability to do, he wants to use them for his kingdom and his glory. Amen? We're his workmanship. We're created in Christ Jesus for good works. And then the last verse ties it all together, wraps it up. Verse 12, Ephesians 2:12. Remember, you were at a time separate from Christ, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in this world. Folks, those are our conditions without Christ. We're blind. We're bound. We're under God's wrath. We're destined for hell. We're helpless. We're hopeless. We're spiritually dead until Jesus comes into our life and changes all that. Amen? And that person you're praying for and your friend who's without Christ, they have all those conditions about them until Jesus changes all that. And that's what we're praying for today. That's what we want to see happen, is for God to move on somebody's life. Folks, we're in the lost and found business. A friend of mine who pastors, he's from North Carolina. His name's Pat Kilby. He pastors in Oklahoma. And he was in a Walmart one time and observed this picture that I want to share with you. It was a little boy, 5 or 6 years old. He was just playing in the toy department at Walmart. Just having a good old time, getting all the toys down, riding around. And he was having fun. And all of a sudden, he got tired of playing in the toys and started looking for his mom. And he goes and looks down one aisle and doesn't see his mom. And now he starts screaming, Mama, Mama, where are you? He goes and looks down the other aisle and he doesn't see his mom. And now he is really screaming, Mama, Mama, where are you? When he discovered he was lost, he got scared. And he started screaming for mom. And Pat said, Marty, as I got in my car to drive away, I was thinking about the little boy and the toys at Walmart. He's just like people in our society. There's people all around us that are just playing in the toy department of life until they discover they're lost. And when they discover they're lost, they start screaming out for somebody to help them, for somebody to save them. Folks, you and I, we got people all around us every day. They're not screaming out loud like the little boy, but in their hearts, they are screaming out loud in their hearts for somebody to tell them the truth, somebody to give them hope, somebody to show them the way home. Folks, we're in the lost and found business. Now, as I conclude this time, I'll share another story. I gave this illustration I just shared with you about the little boy at Walmart at a prayer conference one time years ago. And a lady literally ran up to me at the end of the service and said, I saw the reverse of your story. I saw a mama who had lost her little girl at Kmart and was going through the store yelling for Susie. Now, folks, you all know it's a desperate thing to lose a small child in our culture today. It's a desperate thing. Dawson's 14 years old now. But when he was 2 years old, I was at a prayer conference in Conover, North Carolina. We were staying at a hotel right off of I-40 near Hickory. And I was at the church, and I was waiting for them, my family, to come for dinner. And we were getting ready to start the conference that night. And I called and said, hey, aren't y'all coming to dinner? They said, Dad, you got to pray. We can't find Dawson. He's missing. And for 45 minutes, they were looking for him. He had gotten on the elevator and gotten off on another floor. This is right off I-40. Folks, that is a desperate feeling to lose a child. It's a desperate feeling. Okay, well, this lady's telling me this story. And she said this lady was going through Kmart. She was crying, and she was yelling for Susie. And she said, Marty, that's the most beautiful scene. All of a sudden, the little girl comes around the corner. The little girl's crying. The mom's crying. And that little girl runs to her mom, and her mom drops down on her knees and grabs up her little girl in her arms and said, oh, Susie, I'm so glad I found you. I'm so glad I found you. Folks, that's a picture of God. That's a picture of God. The Bible says that all of heaven rejoices when that one lost sheep is found. Folks, if all of heaven is rejoicing over that one lost sheep, do you not think that's important? If all of heaven's rejoicing over that one lost sheep being found. Folks, that's a message to you and I. We need to be concerned about the lost sheep. We need to be concerned about lost people. We're in the lost and found business. Folks, that kind of reminds me of Jim Valvano. You know, we're in basketball season now. In 1982, I was a freshman at Carolina, and Carolina won the national championship. My sophomore year, 1983, NC State won the national championship. And Jim Valvano was the coach. And in my mind's eye, I think heaven must look like Jim Valvano. When that last shot went in, he was sitting on the edge of his seat, and all of a sudden that shot went in, and he sprung off the thing, and he starts running around, and he's hugging somebody here, and he's hugging somebody there. He was just so full of himself, he couldn't stop turning around and jumping up and down. Folks, that's what I think heaven looks like when somebody comes to know Christ. Amen. If heaven's getting all that excited about it, we should too. Amen. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time. Thank you for your word that is so rich and so powerful and transforming. Father, I thank you for everyone here today who knows Jesus as Lord and Savior, and they have no doubt or concern or question about it. But Father, there may be somebody here today that's not 100% sure of where they're going to be and what they're going to see when they face judgment. And Father, all of us have somebody on our heart today that we're concerned about their eternal destiny. So Father, I pray during this invitation time that we'll come to this altar, we'll bow down and do business with you, the Holy Heavenly Father, and pray for that person that God's put on our heart. Father, maybe we have a decision we need to make today. Maybe we need to just surrender ourselves in a fresh way. Maybe we have never been baptized and we need to profess baptism and profess you publicly. And Father, maybe we're here today and we've never surrendered to Jesus for the first time. Folks, if you're here today, I'm going to pray an example of a prayer. There's nothing perfect about the prayer, it's just words. But this may be the attitude of your heart. If you've never really prayed and asked Jesus into your heart, this is how you can pray. With your head bowed, your eyes closed, and your heart wide open, listen to what I'm saying and see if this is you today. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for loving me. Lord, I know that you died on the cross for my sins. Lord, I confess to you I'm a sinner, and I need your forgiveness. Lord, please come into my life, come into my heart, and forgive me of my sins and cleanse me. I need you. Lord, as best I understand it, I surrender my life to you. I give you my life. I let you be Lord and boss of my life. Father, I pray that you would fill me with your Spirit. Make me the person you want me to be. I surrender my life to you today for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Folks, this is our time of response, our time of invitation. I'm going to ask that our instrumentalists will play through once or twice before Steve comes to lead us in song, because I want you to stand, if you will, and come to this altar. Please stand, if you will. Stand here this time. Come to this altar and pray for that person God's put on your heart. If you're you're here today and you need to make a decision of some sort, or maybe you need somebody to pray for you, Pastor Donnie will be down front, I'll be down front. But you come down, pray for that person God's put on your heart. This altar's open. You come and pray now. Maybe you need to just surrender the fresh one. You come and pray. Come and surrender. Maybe you're here today and you're not 100% sure and you need to talk to Pastor Donnie. You come. You come now, this time. You respond. We're going to play through once or twice before we sing.